Good afternoon, and welcome to the Woodrow Wilson School. My name is Cecilia Rouse, and I'm the dean here. Less than 50 miles south of Princeton is Mount Laurel, home of one of the most significant and controversial court decisions that led to unprecedented legislative action in the housing community. The New Jersey Supreme Court ruled in 1975 and 1983 that it's unconstitutional for municipalities to prevent affordable housing opportunities. As a result, municipalities became required to create affordable housing for low and moderate income households. The ruling ushered in groundbreaking civil rights legislation. In 1985, the New Jersey legislature adopted the Fair Housing Act, which later created the Council on Affordable Housing. The Fair Share Housing Center says approximately 40,000 affordable housing units have been built in New Jersey as a result of the Mount Laurel litigation. Some scholars have likened the Mount Laurel decisions to the fair housing version of Brown v. Board of Education. With us today are three experts on affordable housing. Adam Gordon is a staff attorney at the Fair Share Housing Center. David Kinsey is a visiting lecturer at the Wilson School and a partner in the planning and historic preservation consulting firm of Kinsey and Hand. And Doug Massey is the Henry G. Bryant Professor of Sociology and Public Affairs at the Wilson School. Massey and Kinsey's new book, Climbing Mount Laurel, focuses on the Ethel Lawrence Homes, a housing development that benefited from the Supreme Court decision. I'm pleased to welcome them to here to discuss affordable housing and social mobility in an American suburb. And I would also like to welcome you all to a book signing and reception in Schultz's dining room following the lecture and questions. So welcome and thank you.
Good afternoon. In 1972, as the dean just said, a litigation began. A trial court judge ruled that rapidly suburbanizing Mount Laurel Township, a suburb of Camden, had used its zoning to exclude the poor and block their efforts to build subsidized housing. The resulting Mount Laurel doctrine has changed New Jersey. In 2000, after three decades of litigation, planning, and construction, the first residents finally moved into Ethel Lawrence Homes, the 140-unit new neighborhood of affordable rental townhouses built in Mount Laurel as part of the remedy in this landmark civil rights housing opportunity and land use litigation. Today, Professor Massey will present important findings on the effects of affordable housing on residents, neighbors, and the host community, based on his rigorous multi-year study of Ethel Lawrence Homes. It was my honor to be part of the research team.
Thank you, Doug.
My task today is to establish the context for this panel. The Mount Laurel saga began in the late 1960s. When poor black longtime residents of Mount Laurel Township attempted to build 36 affordable garden apartments. Many residents then lived in a ramshackle area of converted chicken coops and shacks without indoor plumbing. Fearful of being forced to move to Camden slums, they organized. Led by Ethel Lawrence, a sixth-generation resident, day school teacher, and mother of nine, they established the nonprofit Springville Action Committee, optioned a building site, and approached the township for needed approvals. Mount Laurel Township rejected their requests, its mayor infamously telling the residents, "If you people can't afford to live in our town, then you'll just have to leave." Meanwhile, attorneys at Camden Regional Legal Services, part of President Lyndon Johnson's War on Poverty, had already researched suburban exclusionary zoning, identified potential litigation targets, and were looking for plaintiffs. A minister connected Ethel Lawrence with legal services attorney Carl Bisgayer, who conceived and filed the resulting litigation in 1971. The complaint contended that the township had excluded people on the basis of class and race and through its zoning ordinance, and that the township had an affirmative obligation to create a realistic opportunity to address diverse housing needs. This was not an isolated lawsuit. Other initiatives to open the suburbs were then taking place all across the United States. Advocates and scholars, including Professor Michael Danielson of this school, focused public attention on this issue. The original Mount Laurel litigation twice reached the New Jersey Supreme Court, which established the doctrine in 1975 and emphatically reaffirmed it in 1983. The court took strong steps to end exclusionary zoning and established the affirmative obligation of all New Jersey municipalities under the state constitution to afford a realistic opportunity for the construction of their fair share of the regional need for low and moderate income housing. In 1975, the court also directed Mount Laurel Township to amend its zoning ordinance to permit multifamily housing and address its fair share of the regional, not just local, housing need. In 1983, the court rejected the township's continuing intransigence, calling its amended zoning ordinance, quote, little more than a smokescreen that attempts to hide the township's persistent intention to exclude housing for the poor, close quotes. 2 years later, the township and plaintiffs reached a settlement agreement that committed the township to satisfy its fair share housing obligation with a multi-site approach, including the housing long sought by Ethel Lawrence. The parties agreed that a nonprofit developer designated by the plaintiffs would develop 255 units of rental affordable housing at a minimum density of 10 units per acre on at least two sites anywhere in Mount Laurel. The plaintiffs designated Fair Share Housing Development, Inc., a nonprofit developer of affordable housing with supportive education, recreation, and social services programs. One of the plaintiff's four original attorneys, Peter O'Connor, founded Fair Share Housing Development in 1986. O'Connor then scoured the township and optioned three sites. Ethel Lawrence participated in the site selection process. One site was a 62-acre parcel of farmland surrounded by woods and wetlands. Acquired for $20,000 per acre, this property became the site of Ethel Lawrence Homes. Planning for the project began in earnest in 1995. O'Connor sketched and refined the concept plan on napkins at Ponzio's Diner in Cherry Hill. Township residents may have feared a repeat of the failed public housing projects of the 1950s. O'Connor wanted them to visit and only be able to criticize that the development was too nice. The resulting site plan begins with a long landscape boulevard through an opening in the woods, leading to a village green. Four courts radiate from the roadway that rings the central green. Each court has 28 to 40 townhouses. The small, simply detailed two-story structures, each with four units, are arrayed around the courts. Each townhouse has front and back doors, which open to additional common lawns and landscaped areas. The project has a low gross density of 2.25 units per acre. Fair Share Housing Development applied in 1986 to the Mount Laurel Township Planning Board for the necessary approvals. Tempestuous public hearings took place in early 1997. As the plans conformed to the zoning ordinance previously negotiated with the township and approved by the trial court, the planning board had little discretion and unanimously approved the project. Fair Share Housing Development financed and built Ethel Lawrence Homes in two phases for about $27 million, or $200,000 per unit. Affordable housing under the Mount Laurel Doctrine is typically only affordable only to households with incomes that hover around 40 to 60% of the regional median income. Without a deeper range of affordability, O'Connor realized that the low-income plaintiffs who were the original impetus for the project would not be able to afford to live at Ethel Lawrence Homes. To build a high-quality project and achieve a range of affordability of unprecedented depth and breadth from 10% to 80% of regional median, O'Connor cobbled together an extraordinary package of federal low-income housing tax credit equity, grants, developer contributions, developer equity, and deferred fees, and eight layers of mortgages. The New Jersey Housing and Mortgage Finance Agency was the most significant lender. The symbolism of honoring Ethel Lawrence, who had died in 1994, certainly contributed to assembling the necessary subsidies. Construction began on phase one in 1999. Fair Share Housing Development received 868 initial applications from prospective tenants for the first 100 units. The first tenants moved to their new homes in 2000. Construction began on phase two in 2003. more than 1,800 people picked up applications for the final 40 townhouses, which were completed in 2004. Ironically, none of the original plaintiffs or their families moved to Ethel Lawrence Homes. It is important to consider Ethel Lawrence Homes in the context of the record of the Mount Laurel Doctrine and its uncertain future. The doctrine has, in my opinion, transformed positively New Jersey and inspired housing advocates and planners nationwide. More affordable housing per capita per year has been built in New Jersey than in any other state, ahead of California and Massachusetts, even with the last lost decade plus of executive branch attempts to undermine the doctrine. Nearly $600 million has been collected by municipal affordable housing trust funds. By my calculations, about 60,000 affordable units, based on COA data, have been produced, but that's only 8% of the total housing built in the same period. Three housing types account for most of this new affordable housing. Initially, the private sector developed most of this housing as inclusionary developments, mixing affordable with market rate units. But public policy changes influenced the shift to more 100% affordable housing developments, such as Ethel Lawrence Homes. Increased use of this model makes the insights reported in Climbing Mount Laurel particularly timely and important. For more than a decade, the Mount Laurel Doctrine has been on hold. Defanging the doctrine is one of Governor Christie's stated reasons for remolding the New Jersey Supreme Court. Unraveling the doctrine would, in effect, return New Jersey to the era of exclusion, when families, working families, poor people, people of color, people with special needs, struggled to find decent, affordable housing and opportunity in many communities, even more than they struggle today. The current fragile status of the Mount Laurel Doctrine is nothing new. Except for very brief periods, the story of the doctrine is a tale of struggle, frustration, and delay. But despite the obstacles, significant affordable housing has been built. I continue to hope that the positive story of Ethel Lawrence Homes will contribute to nurturing a more supportive climate for the decent affordable housing that continues to be needed throughout New Jersey and the nation. Thank you. Doug.
I was fortunate enough to be a graduate student here at Princeton from 1975 to 1978 when I received my PhD in sociology. And I did my dissertation on patterns and levels of residential segregation in the United States. So in the news at the time, I was listening to the Mount Laurel controversy bubbling up and grabbing headlines. I came back to Princeton in 2003 to learn that only in late 2000, early 2001, had the housing project that was envisioned by the Mount Laurel lawsuit finally been built after 25 or 30 years of delays and procrastination. The project had finally opened. And I saw this as an opportunity to address a number of issues that are both of academic and policy concern. Academically, there's a large debate among scholars about whether neighborhoods really matter in people's lives. And I've been in the camp that believes that neighborhoods do matter. And I saw this as an effort to show how neighborhoods could really change the trajectory of people's lives in a very positive way. Public policy-wise, the concerns of the community that were expressed over and over and over again in letter editor and testimony before city council and zoning hearings were that if you build a project like this in a nice, affluent, white suburb like Mount Laurel, New Jersey, you're going to destroy it. You're going to cause an increase in taxes, you're going to cause a decrease in property values, and you're going to bring about an increase in crime rates. So my purpose as a social scientist was to bring the tools of social science to bear to address these issues, to first look at what effect the opening of this project, this development, had on Mount Laurel and the surrounding neighborhoods. Did the negative prognostications of rising crime, falling home values, and rising taxes come about? And the second issue was, what difference did being able to move into a nice development of 140 townhouse units in an affluent white suburb, what difference did that make in the lives of the people who were fortunate enough to get housing? So what I'm going to do is present in a very quick thumbnail way the results of our study. As you can see, and as David already told you, the development was designed so as not to stigmatize the residents, but to blend in with the surrounding community. I ask you, which of these is the affordable housing? If you look closely, you'll see that there's more stonework in the bottom right, but the architecturally, visually, at a very quick glance, it's very difficult to tell the difference. And it was explicitly designed in this way so as not to create an eyesore, so as not to replicate the mistakes of the past, and so as not to stigmatize these people in this otherwise well-manicured suburban community. So to study the effect of the project on the community, we undertook what's called a multiple control group time series experiment, where you have this is Mount Laurel here. You have a bunch of observations before. The treatment is the opening of the project, the development in 2001, and then a bunch of observations afterwards. And you pick some very similar surrounding townships that are like Mount Laurel, only they didn't get the treatment of the affordable housing, and you look at the trends. And so we picked Cinnaminship Township, Cherry Hill Township, and Evesham Township as comparison cases for Mount Laurel, and we did a lot of analyses to show that they're very comparable to one another. And then we do a time series analysis. So what you see here is crime trends and crime rates, with Mount Laurel being the solid line right here, the very heavy line. And as you see, crime rates are rising, crime rates are falling throughout the period. It's a period when crime rates are falling all over the United States, all over the country. And if you look at the trends, they don't look very different between Mount Laurel and the surrounding townships or the state as a whole. And when you do the statistical tests, difference kind of test, you find that, in fact, there's no difference, that the opening of the Ethel Lawrence homes had no detectable statistical effect on crime rates in Mount Laurel, New Jersey. When you look at property values, again, the very thick black line is Mount Laurel, you see that property values are going up over the entire period, and they were going up roughly the same pace in Mount Laurel as the surrounding townships. There was, of course, the mortgage meltdown and the housing crisis in 2008, which affected everyone. But in fact, it affected Mount Laurel a little bit less than some of the other townships nearby, particularly Cherry Hills Township, which actually plummeted. And when you do the test, you find statistically that there's no difference in the property values before and after the opening of Mount Laurel, and there's no difference in the rate of increase in property values between Mount Laurel and the comparison townships afterwards. This is a little more microscopic look. Here we're looking at the adjacent neighborhoods, the neighborhoods immediately adjacent to the place where they built the Ethel Lawrence homes, and the dotted line at the bottom is Hillside Lane. The dotted line at the bottom is Holiday Village, which is directly across the street and which is an age-restricted community for people 55 and older, and built in very much the same style and the same organization as Ethel Lawrence Homes. The dashed line at the top is Hillside Lane, which is a more upscale neighborhood. So you can see that property values rose, and there's virtually no difference between Hillside Lane and Mount Laurel in general, and Mount Laurel and Holiday Village, Hillside Lane and Holiday Village. When you do the statistical tests, once again, you find no detectable effect of the opening of the Ethel Lawrence homes on property values, even in the most adjacent neighborhoods. Finally, we look at tax rates and the effect of tax rates for Mount Laurel and three comparison townships. And once again, tax rates were falling. The effective tax rates went up a bit and then fell, and then there's another reevaluation and they went up again. But when you run through the statistics, Yet again, there's no detectable effect of the opening of Ethel Lawrence homes on tax rates in Mount Laurel Township compared to other very similar townships nearby. Now, we move to our efforts to assess the effect of the being able to move into Ethel Lawrence homes on the residents. And here we use a match control group comparison, where we have one group, which is Mount Laurel residents, the Ethel Lawrence home tenants, people who moved into Mount Laurel. We ask about questions, what their lives were like before, after they moved into the Ethel Lawrence homes, and then observe them afterwards. And we have a comparison group where we observe before and after at the same times, but they didn't get to move into the project. And R, with a line through it, means it's not random assignment. You can't really do random assignment. And whenever you don't have random assignment, there's a potential of bias of what social scientists call selectivity. Maybe the people who selected themselves into the population of people who wanted to move into a place like Ethel Lawrence Homes were different from the people you compared them to. So what we did here for our comparison group is we took, it's a waiting list system, first come, first serve. And so what we did was take our sample of tenants, and then we took a sample of people from the waiting list, people who had self-selected into the same population of people who want to move into a place like Ethel Lawrence Homes, but were still farther down the waiting list and hadn't made it in. We have all the information from the application form, including position on the waiting list, and we're able to, with this, do a technique called propensity score matching, where we actually match up people who are tenants and people who are non-residents. So residents, people who got to move in, and non-residents, people who wanted to move in but didn't get the opportunity at the time we did the study. So that's our comparison. It's a quasi-experimental design. And just to give you a sense for the data, this is an index of neighborhood disorder and violence that we computed from a questionnaire. We did surveys, a detailed survey of all the residents, everybody who'd ever lived in Ethel Lawrence homes, and including people who'd moved out, who'd moved there and then already moved out, and people from the waiting list. And as you can see, this shows you the importance of having a control group. Crime rates were falling throughout New Jersey, and you can see that for even non-residents, crime rates fell. But when you look at the residents, you see that crime rates fell a whole lot more. Their neighborhood conditions dramatically improved, and this isn't rocket science. They moved out of poor neighborhoods in North Philadelphia and Camden, and they moved into Mount Laurel, New Jersey, which is an affluent, very safe and secure, predominantly white suburb of Philadelphia. So we just show what common sense would dictate, that there was a pronounced drop in the exposure to disorder and violence. The rest of the slides I'm going to show you look like this. This is these are bar graphs, obviously, but they're based on statistical models that I've estimated. And this just simply compares the experimental and the control group, residents with non-residents, with no controls whatsoever. And here we throw in a bunch of controls in a multivariate model, and here we do propensity score matching. So we actually batch as closely as we can the people, and we observe what happens. So in the uncontrolled case, there's a huge and very significant drop in exposure to disorder and violence as a result of moving in. That holds up no matter what kind of statistical comparison we do. So it shows pretty conclusively, and again, this isn't rocket science, that if you give people the opportunity to move from a distressed inner city neighborhood into a nice white affluent suburb like Mount Laurel, their neighborhood conditions improve dramatically. We also asked people, we had them fill out a schedule of exposure to negative life events. And again, when people moved from where they lived into the Ethel Lawrence homes, they experienced a dramatic reduction in exposure to negative life events, getting mugged, having your house burgled, being harassed by the police, experiencing homelessness, all these sorts of things that can really disrupt people's lives were dramatically reduced in frequency as a result. And we also looked at mental distress. We asked a series of questions about anxiety and things like not being able to sleep. It's a standard mental health inventory. And we find, again, a significant and fairly sustained drop in degree of mental distress people experience. And in separate analyses that I don't have time to show you here, we found the driver here is by moving in from a high disorder, high crime, high violent neighborhood into a low disorder, low crime, low crime neighborhood. They experience fewer negative life events, and because they experience fewer negative life events and are less exposed to disorder and crime, their mental health improves. And the longer they live in the Ethel Lawrence homes, the more improvement their mental health sustains. So the longer they live there, the calmer they get. We also looked at economic independence. We looked at income. We looked at employment rates. We looked at amount of income earned from labor. Looked at welfare dependency rates. And we created they're very interrelated with one another, so we created a factor scale to measure economic independence. And as you can see, by moving into Ethel Lawrence homes, there was a huge boost in economic independence that sustained under all comparison conditions. By moving in, they got access. They became better employees because they were not depressed. They were not constantly dealing with negative events in their lives. They weren't stressed out by living in a disordered neighborhood. And because Mount Laurel's a job-rich area, they moved into an area that's abundant with opportunities for work, with office parks, with motels, with malls, with strip malls, with all kinds of opportunities. And employment rates went dramatically up, and the earnings from employment went dramatically up. And the longer they stayed, the longer they were able to live there, the more economically independent they became. So this is a summary of what we found with the size of the effects put in. By moving into Ethel Lawrence, they had a reduction in exposure to disorder and violence, a reduction in the exposure to negative life events as a result, improved mental health, and a more economic independence. Now we turn to the kids, the children of the people who moved in to the Ethel Lawrence homes. And here we look at the likelihood that a child has a quiet place to study. Having a quiet place to study is an important input into being able to be academically successful. And you see that when we apply the control conditions, we find a huge and quite significant increase in the likelihood that they have a place to study. They moved in from cramped, deteriorating housing into nice townhouse housing with more space. We looked at the degree which parents were involved in the education of their kids, the degree to which they went to parent-teacher conferences, attended PTA meetings, took their kids to the museum, took their kids to the aquarium, things like that. And we found big increases in parental involvement in the education of their kids. Not surprising, because the parents are not stressed out, they're not depressed, they're not dealing with emergencies constantly in their lives, and they have time to devote to the education of their children. The longer they're there, the more likely they are higher the degree of their involvement in the academics of their kids. And here is the effect of hours studied per week. So you can see that once we apply the controls, that more than 6 hours additional per week as a result of moving into the home. They are doing a lot more study time, a lot more effort devoted towards their school as a result of shifting from where they used to live into the Ethel Lawrence homes. The longer the students are there, the more time they spend studying. And not surprisingly, under all the control conditions, when you control, you reduce the effect a bit, but it's always highly significant. They're able to access much higher quality schools. And again, this isn't rocket science. They move out of places like Camden, which is the worst school district in the state of New Jersey, if not the nation. And they move into Mount Laurel, New Jersey, which is one of the top school districts. And so the quality of the schools that they access goes way up in terms of test scores, in terms of facilities, in terms of AP courses, in terms of all these educational benefits. And here's what we found, for a summary of what we found for the kids. By moving into ELH at the Lawrence Homes, studied more, they got access to more supportive parental behavior, quiet place to study, more higher quality schools and lower exposure to school disorder and violence, disorder and violence within their school. And if you notice that the direct effect of moving in is negative, they lowers their grade point average. That's because they move from a very uncompetitive to a very competitive school environment. But and other things equal, they would probably suffer a drop of almost a third of a grade point. But these other factors intervene and counterbalance. And so in the end, when you look at the difference, there's no difference in the grades. They earn just as good a grade as they would have if they'd stayed where they were, except now they're in a much better, more competitive school, getting a higher quality education. And David's already gone through the funding, so let me skip to the conclusions. Conclusions are that it's indeed possible to build affordable housing in an affluent suburb without negative effects on the host community. We found no effect on taxes, property values, or crime rates. And for adults who are able to move and take advantage of the affordable housing, moving to an affluent suburb improves life. It reduces exposure to disorder and violence, lowers the frequency of negative life events, improves mental health, increases economic independence, does not reduce social support, which I didn't talk about, but it's true. For children, access to affordable housing in the affluent suburb improves their educational outcomes, improves learning conditions at home, increases hours of study, improves school quality, reduces exposure to disorder and violence within schools, and does not result in a drop in grade achievement. They're able to earn the same grades they would have earned, only now it's a much higher quality education. And finally, we conclude that affordable housing developed under the low-income housing tax credit is a cost-effective way to promote racial and class integration and to promote social mobility of the disadvantaged. So it's a win-win situation for everyone. There were no negative effects, no negative externalities imposed on the neighborhoods around around the Ethel Lawrence homes, no negative effects imposed on the residents of Mount Laurel generally. The residents of Ethel Lawrence Homes got a huge boost in their life trajectory and were able to work themselves out of poverty and become taxpayers and get off the welfare rolls. And it was financed in with tax credits and loans in ways that imposed very little in the way of a burden on the taxpayers of the state of New Jersey. So it's a win-win-win for everyone, which of course is why Governor Christie is trying to get rid of it.
Hi, I'm Adam Gordon. I'm an attorney with Fair Share Housing Center, and it's great to be here at Princeton. I grew up in South Brunswick, and my parents are Gil and Ellen are right over there, and I remember being in Princeton growing up mainly as one of those teenagers hanging out in Palmer Square that you all probably see. And so it's fun to be back here speaking. And thanks to David and Doug for excellent presentations. It's just been really wonderful to be able to quantify the impacts of the work that we do and the things that we know anecdotally from talking to people in Ethel Lawrence Homes and other developments throughout the state to actually comprehensively and really what is the most comprehensive study of any housing program in the country to really identify the individual inputs and how they are working together to produce educational and economic and safety results. So it's been really wonderful to have Climbing Mount Laurel out, and I encourage all of you to read it if you haven't already. I want to speak from more of a policy perspective on why Mount Laurel has worked in many ways and produced, as David mentioned, more homes than any similar program in any other state. And I want to talk about that largely from a macro policy level, but also to some degree on a micro policy level, building off of some of the things Doug was talking about in terms of impact on people's lives. And then I want to identify, I think, three key factors in creating that success that I think are fairly unique to how New Jersey has made this work and different from how a lot of other states have done similar programs. And I want to talk about how Governor Christie has tried to undermine each of those three factors over the past few years. And then and then talk about briefly at the end where we're going next. So, I think it's really important to think about Mount Laurel on a macro level, not only in terms of the number of homes produced, and I think if we have to update, the most recent numbers are more like 60,000, and really reflect that a lot of homes that were planned for back in the 80s and 90s ended up being built during the boom, and also a lot of the developments that David showed in his presentation, a lot of the developments, including Ethel Lawrence Homes, but many of the developments you showed in Deptford and Cape May and so on, were built through the low-income housing tax credit program, which really didn't exist at the time of Mount Laurel II, and really took a while to get up and running, and really took a while to get integrated into the infrastructure of implementation of Mount Laurel, and I'll come back to that in a little while. But you know, there's those 60,000 homes that are these very direct impacts, and there's the people who live in them. But I also think it's really critical to think about what Mount Laurel was originally designed to address, which was exclusionary zoning. And the impact of that, I always tell people about, a couple of years ago I was in South Carolina, and I saw these new townhouses being developed, and they were on sale, and there's a sign that says starting from the 120s. And I thought about this in the context of especially being from this area. And we think of that as heavily subsidized housing, but in much of the country, that is housing that the market produces. And the reason why in New Jersey that doesn't happen is because of these restrictive zoning policies, by and large. We're building the same homes, and we probably have a little bit higher labor costs and material costs, but the real problem is that land is so scarce and so expensive in New Jersey because of artificial restrictions on supply. And it's really important, and I think the best study of this is Stu Meck's study that was published by the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy. For those of you who don't know Stu, he's a professor at Rutgers at Blaustein, and he looked at the macro effects of Mount Laurel on the housing market in New Jersey. And what he found is that Mount Laurel has had a really important impact not just on the 60,000 people who, and that's 60,000 families who currently live, or households who currently live in the homes that have been developed, but also that there's about 100,000 homes that are middle-class, non-affordable homes that wouldn't have been developed except for the changes in zoning that really that came about from Mount Laurel, and that the availability of those homes on the market significantly reduced the cost of housing to everybody in New Jersey. He studied really the 1990s, which was probably the decade in which all this was working the best. That in that decade, that while all other similarly situated states that had restrictive zoning and growth control saw significant increases in rents and sales prices, New Jersey did not see that. And so you have to look at not just what the impact is on the individual people who end up in the homes, but also more broadly on addressing exclusion and expanding the number of housing choices that are available. It's funny to, because this sounds like a very market-driven libertarian argument. And that's the strange thing about Mount Laurel, is that it is sort of a combination of very progressive civil rights values and very libertarian concepts about property rights and development. And the constituency that supported it historically has been that sort of strange bedfellow combination of people, civil rights groups like our own, and also people who are very interested in actually building these homes and who are not able, under New Jersey's very restrictive zoning, to get permits to develop those homes. At the micro level, I think it's important to talk about who lives in these houses. Early on in Mount Laurel, there's a study in the Seton Hall Law Journal in the 90s showing that most of the people who moved into Mount Laurel housing were really people who were already living in the suburbs and who were predominantly white. That has changed, and there's a recent study in a law journal at Rutgers by Stephanie Bush-Vesquet that surveys people who currently live in Mount Laurel housing, and it's become much more diverse. And you know, Ethel Lawrence Homes is probably exceptional because it reaches such low income levels and because there's been such a strong affirmative marketing. But more generally, you know, the promise of Mount Laurel being used to encourage greater racial and economic integration has increasingly been realized in ways that it hasn't and had not in the early days. That has helped produce a lot of the effects and real transformations in people's lives that that Doug mentioned. And I also think, you know, transformations in communities' lives. I mean, the community I grew up in, South Brunswick, which had has done one of the best records in New Jersey on Mount Laurel housing, has become, I think, a very much more diverse community as a result, both racially and economically. And I think that's been a very good thing for the community. So why has this policy had such a big effect and comparably more than in other states? I think there's three main reasons. The first is that there are objective criteria that were used to develop what each town's fair share should be, so what each town had to do. The second is that there was an independent agency, or somewhat independent agency, the Council on Affordable Housing, enforcing it. And I know we have two former directors of the council here, Art Bernard, who was the director under Governor Florio, Shirley Bishop, who was the director of under Governor Whitman, Mary Beth Lonergan, who was one of the principal planners at COA. And there were a really good group of people who came together and really made this work, and there was some insulation, although, you know, nothing is that far from the political process, but there was some insulation in the day-to-day work to some degree in the political process from those decisions. And also, as a backstop to that, you had another independent entity, the courts, that were basically always there as a backstop to enforce obligations, and so that was a real incentive for things to happen. And that was a structure with this independent agency that was created by the New Jersey legislature in response to the Mount Laurel decisions. Now, former Senator Stockman is here, who was a critical participant in those debates. And, you know, there were some good things about that process and bad things about that process. But overall, it was a process that has led to a lot of homes being built. And the final thing is really funding. And David mentioned this in his presentation, that there's been both public and private sector sources of funding. And over time, as I started to mention before, there's been an increasing amount of public sector funding for this, both from these municipal trust funds that David mentioned and also from federal money through the Low Income Housing Tax Credit Program, which is increasingly, partly in response to litigation that we brought about 10 years ago, been directed towards helping towns meet their Mount Laurel requirements. And F. Lawrence Homes is one of many examples of that. So the governor, who is a very smart lawyer, has attempted to undermine each of these things. And we've spent the past several years basically fighting him on each of these fronts. The first is really the objective nature of what municipal obligations are. Excuse me. He's proposed in an even more radical form than two prior governors before him. There's the idea that towns should only have to have affordable housing as they grow, which initially sounded like a good idea. But the logistical problems of implementing that, which have now sort of failed to work in different forms in three gubernatorial administrations under McGreevy, Florio, and now Christie. Although I think Christie's even much more so than the prior two, really trying to use it to undermine the entire doctrine, is that it just creates this level of uncertainty that is always there. You never know, you know, your obligation. You get an obligation when something gets developed, but you don't know if that's going to be developed next year or the year after, and you're sort of constantly recalibrating if you're a municipal government, what you think you have to do. And the problem is that, and it also gives you an incentive to try to block market rate development. And that is something that now the New Jersey Supreme Court most recently has said is not consistent with Mount Laurel and the Fair Housing Act. And so, that's been something that he's tried to implement but has been blocked. The second is really independence. The governor of New Jersey is the strongest governor in the country. And this governor has tried to take that power in many areas, including this one, and make it even stronger. And he's tried twice to get rid of the Council on Affordable Housing without the legislature's approval. The courts have blocked him from doing so and said that he does not have that authority absent the legislature affirmatively approving. And more generally, of course, he's taken several unprecedented steps in terms of not renominating Supreme Court justices, not following the historical balance between parties on the Supreme Court, and really trying to make the court system more politicized and less independent. And the third is, in terms of funding, the governor has attempted to, in a now year-plus long battle, and that has found us strangely on the same side as the New Jersey League of Municipalities, who we often are fighting with, attempted to take these municipal trust funds to basically plug a hole in the state's budget, which the New Jersey Appellate Division Supreme Court have blocked several times. There's still a lot of back and forth in that. And so he has really attempted to, but so far has been blocked by the courts and the legislature at every turn, undermine what I think are the three key pillars of this. So I'll conclude by briefly talking about where we're going, and I think it's hard to know. People ask me this a lot, and we now have one big question out of the way, which is what was going to happen in the election earlier this week, and basically we have the status quo for both the governor and the legislature, so we're probably going to be in roughly the same position that we've been in over the last few years. Currently, the governor has, and the Council on Affordable Housing have till the end of February to come up with new rules that are consistent with sort of the older way of doing things, which who knows if he will actually do or not. The legislature has previously sent legislation that would overhaul the Fair Housing Act to the governor, but he's vetoed it, and there hasn't been substantial legislative activity since. So we're kind of in a place in which there's sort of a standoff between the legislature and the courts, really, on one side and the governor on the other. And what happens with that, I don't know, but I suspect that as we approach that February deadline, we will find out. I'll stop there. Thanks.
I had a question about the low-income housing tax credit as a basis for much of this development. So there's lots of issues with the low-income tax credit. People find it inefficient, very complex, but then again, it is the vehicle for much of the federal funding on this issue.
Under Ronald Reagan, by the way.
What's that?
Passed under Ronald Reagan.
Yeah. And so, yes.
He'd be considered a raving liberal today.
That's true. Given that one of the criticisms low-income tax, I can never get the word out, is that...
Light C, everybody says. Low-income housing tax credit, light C.
Light C.
Light C.
We used to sell LIHTC, which is just too many letters. So that it helps the people on the upper end of low income, and you said that this development was particularly good because they made an effort to fit the 10 to 80% of median. So how are other developments dealing with that issue, and do you see this as a model, the bringing in more private funding as a model to make this work in other areas as well?
Let me start. Ethel Lawrence Holmes is, I believe, unique in its package of financial resources that made possible going all the way down to 10% of median. And most low-income housing tax credit funded projects hover, I said, between 40, 50, 60. And so that's unfortunate because there are others that are left out. In some parts and some rental markets in New Jersey, the upper range of moderate, 70, 75, 80% is market rate. But it's the lower range, part of the range, that is the hardest to provide such housing for. So Ethel Lawrence Holmes put together a package of resources. That's what made it possible to offer and continue to offer housing that's far broader than a standard low-income housing tax credit project.
Hi, thank you for being here today. I have a question about the sort of applicability of these results to other situations. I know that there's been sort of a national trend that suburbs are seeing increasing levels of poverty and diversity throughout the country, and a lot of things we think of as sort of inner city issues are kind of shifting to inner ring suburbs. And I'm curious if you think that there's sort of an optimal mix where you get the benefits of living in a more affluent area without negative impacts following, or if there's sort of a tipping point where you move, like, too much concentration of poverty in a suburb that's not equipped to deal with it, that doesn't have the services that an inner city might have, could be a negative thing.
Yeah, I think it's a problem often with the way that we talk about suburbs is we use suburbs to refer to a broad range of communities that are really different from each other. And certainly the way that the Mount Laurel doctrine works doesn't apply to all of them equally, and I think that, you know, it should not every suburb is the same place, nor should we think that, you know, any housing that's built in a suburb is automatically, you know, the right thing. I mean, I think and so I do think that part of the reason why Ethel Lorem has been successful is because Mount Laurel is such a desirable place to live, and, you know, Mount Laurel has a lot of jobs, has great schools, has easy access to transportation, although mainly car transportation, but, you know, most low-income people in New Jersey have a car. And so, you know, I certainly wouldn't apply that to a lot of inner ring suburbs, and I just don't think that, you know, every suburb is the same, and also it's not our state policy to treat every suburb the same.
The key in these developments is not to concentrate poverty. So if you take a bunch of Section 8 certificate holders and dump them into a working class suburb that's already on the brink, that just replicates the cycle. The key is to spread people out so that they can take advantage of the advantages of the more affluent suburbs without changing the character of the suburbs themselves and keeping the resources intact. That's the key.
I have a question for each of you. So, Douglas Massey, you said that there's no negative externalities to the transfer of people to the
None that we found.
Right. I was wondering, did you consider the possibility of a negative externality on the people remaining in the Philadelphia and Camden suburbs where those people had come from, in that you've taken some of the most upwardly mobile people out of those communities, therefore concentrating poverty among the people who are left behind, a concept of abandonment? So I'm going to ask you other questions first, and you want to come back to that. So Adam, I had a question for you, and I think this is the same question that the mayor's daughter was asking as well, but to what extent do you think it's a problem for those of us who would like to advocate for affordable housing? The concept that the middle class are kind of cut out here, the idea that you have a hardworking middle class that does not have access to COA-approved housing, who sees a working class population getting an opportunity that is not open to them. So for example, here in Princeton, we have COA housing, but that's for low income people mostly. And there's another class of people just above that, what we call, where I come from, the squeezed middle, who are kind of cut out of that opportunity. And then my final question is for Mr. Kinsey is, what do you see as the barriers to adding more affordable housing right now in 2013? So, if I come back to Mr. Massey, what did you make of the concept of abandonment?
It's a good question, and the options of investing in poor neighborhoods and promoting mobility are often pitched as either or, but they're not. They're not mutually exclusive. And at the same time that you open mobility up to people, it's also another strategy to make investments, targeted investments in neighborhoods. I don't think that 140 people moving out of a variety of different places like Camden and North Philadelphia and some of the poorer suburbs makes a significant difference in the concentration of poverty.
In just that one particular case, but if we had more affordable housing, then you tend to draw more and more of the
But
top
mobility, spatial mobility is part and parcel of social mobility in the United States. Every group that's ever come into the urban America has come in poor, worked their way up the economic ladder. By working their way up the economic ladder, they are able to buy into a better neighborhood. By buying into a better neighborhood, they're able to boost themselves and especially their children further up the ladder. The Jews didn't stay in the Lower East Side. The Italians no longer live down in Little Italy. It's all about mobility, and if you block that spatial mobility, then you, by that very fact, block social mobility. And that is the simple reality of life in a market economy like the United States.
In terms of middle class, I think that's part of the point I was trying to make at the start in terms of So a lot of the impact has been to create more middle class housing, and we support creating more middle class housing. So I think that
how does it create more middle class housing?
If you have 10 acres of land, and your choice is whether you're going to have 10 acres that are 10 houses that are on 1 acre lots, or you're going to have 60 townhouses, of which 12 are affordable and the rest are not affordable, but they're just sold at market rate. Middle-class people can afford those townhouses. They can't afford one-acre lots. And I think in response to Ms. Alvarez, what you said earlier, a lot of places in New Jersey, it'd be illegal today to build your own house on a piece of land that you buy. I think it's wrong that that's illegal, and unless there's something that's environmentally sensitive, we're advocating for homes that everyone can afford, working class, middle class, low income, and I think it's a bad policy to exclude anyone, and I think it's a real problem that Princeton doesn't have enough middle class housing, which is part of why we strongly supported the development of the new Avalon Bay apartments on the hospital site, and we supported the affordable part of that, and we're supporting the market part of that, because all that's important.
Let me answer a bit. My chart showed the predominance of 100% affordable housing, but that model was not the model in the first decade after Mount Laurel, which was more private sector inclusionary development, 80% market rate, 20% affordable, and the housing types were apartments and townhouses, which before that time were not allowed in those communities. That, I think, is a huge change that was brought about and is positive. It happened only because of the Mount Laurel Doctrine, and it benefited working families and middle-class folks all across the state. Secondly, what's blocking affordable housing? Three ingredients are needed to build any housing. One needs a site, an okay site. That means it's got the appropriate zoning, it's suitable, it's in a good location. One needs a site. Second, you need money. A variety of sources, debt, equity, all kinds of things, and that's scarce, and particularly for affordable housing, for income-restricted housing. And third, one needs capacity. A developer, people who know how to do that, that's less of a problem than the first two, but it's still an important consideration.
Thank you, all three of you.
I have a question as it relates to initially starting this program, it being because of exclusionary zoning at this point. I'm wondering if we're getting to the point for those, and I've actually been involved with Mr. Kinsey back in somewhere around 1989 with Bellmead Corporation and Henry Hill. And certainly I think we went into voluntary compliance and we certainly turned out I think the spirit and intent of what was under the Mount Laurel law. I think we ended up with something like 1,340 units total for that total plan unit development. But in the process, that was 10 years ago, or 20 years ago. And in that process, we had the available land to do that. Namely, we were a population base of 10,000, 11,000 at that time. We're nearing the build-out population of sustainability in Montgomery of 22,000. We're about 21,000 now. But yet the requirement for Mount Laurel still keeps coming to us. The oddity here is that with that particular development that you would be familiar with, the Bellmead Corporation, phase two of that development, the applicant came forward and was denied access permits to Route 206 based on the density that was proposed. So as in order to meet compliance, obviously other changes occurred, and changes in the master plan started to occur, which affected the balance of the rateable base. And I started to look at that, although I'm not involved in politics at this point, but I was involved in the master plan development. The balance now seems to be such that we've reached full absorption, even though we would like to go into voluntary compliance. It, again, that wouldn't bother us because most of the time the teachers can't afford to live in the community that we have, and some of the policemen. So that, you know, in order to get a true arrangement, but I don't understand why municipalities still get these mandatory, what may be artificial requirements, which are difficult to figure out.
Well, New Jersey grew by 400,000 people in the last decade, and I guess the response to that can either be, you know, go away, there's just no room, or you just have to sort of, you know, double up in an apartment, or we could try to figure out how we do a lot of redevelopment. And in fact, much of New Jersey's development has been, in the last 10 years, has been redevelopment of existing sites. I don't think that the shopping centers on 206 are always going to remain exactly as they are. And we're seeing that all over the state, you know, shopping centers being redeveloped into a mix of, stores and apartments and so on. Hillsborough is doing that along 206 now with this whole town center project. And I think we're going to see more and more of that. And so I think that unless we're just going to say no more people can live in New Jersey, go away. And in some sense, I do think that that's essentially a lot of what the governor is saying. People continue to want to live here because it's a dynamic state. It's a state with a strong economy. And I think that we have to think about not just, we have to move away from just developing undeveloped farms and forests and looking at more redevelopment in both urban and suburban areas. And in fact, that's happening all over the state. And I think that's increasingly how places that would have never thought about, and I'm not talking about redevelopment of condemnation and so on, but just, you know, market-driven redevelopment. I think there's a lot of communities like Montgomery and Hillsborough being an example that are thinking about those kinds of infill and redevelopment opportunities.
Well, I think the problem we know, and the basic problem, is the fact that in our particular case, and I think it's even felt by Princeton, I saw Marvin Reed back here too. He was in office about the same time I was, and we had litigation against NJDOT. But the highway system in this area, we don't have the infrastructure, basically. The highway system in this area is extremely fragile. And as the densities increase, obviously we're getting to the absorption level's just not there. For example, on September 11th this year, when we had a single accident on Route 206 in Montgomery, the entire region went into gridlock for 4 hours. And that's
maybe,
how.
Maybe you should tear down some of the office parks and force people not to work.
But the question
there.
Is, if
I mean, that's the problem. I mean, the problem is, as long as you're going to continue to have people, you're either telling people commute further and further to their jobs. I mean, people. It's not like there's some artificial. There's demand for people to live here, and I think towns like Montgomery have partly created that demand because they've allowed so many office parks to be developed and chase those ratables. And I think that the problem, I mean, I think the traffic gridlock will be even worse if those people are commuting in from Hunterdon County or from Pennsylvania.
Well, I think that the real reason is I don't think the municipalities have the financial resources to build the infrastructure that's lacking at this point. And certainly outside sources which have customarily been available to do that are no longer available.
I mean, you know, our entire system of government, I mean, from and how it deals with infrastructure and these issues is dysfunctional, and yet we continue to grow and add people, and you know we sort of can keep muddling through on all of this, I think.
Great, I'm going to let that be the last word.
Thank you.
I want to thank the panel for a lovely discussion.